Good afternoon, everyone. In yesterday's lecture, we started the new topic, that is evaluation of symptoms. While reporterizing the case, after taking the case, we first do analysis, then we have to do evaluation of symptoms. In that, we discuss how the evaluation is important. The physician first, we should know how to take the proper case, how to find out the symptoms from the patient, from his relative, as well as with his proper observation, and when he can able to know or he can able to find out all the symptoms from the patient, then only he can able to make the proper totality of the case, totality of the patient, portrait of the patient. In evaluation of the case, the value of symptoms must be taken into consideration on several points. That is, first we have considered general symptom, in that first mental general, then physical general, then location of the suffering. After location, we have to consider the concomitant symptoms, then causative factors, modalities, contradictory symptoms, and lastly, diagnostic symptom of the disease. In general symptoms, first we have to give importance to the mental and emotional characteristics, because it is the expression of the inner person, inner expressions, the person's inner feelings. So it is highest rank in evaluating, because these are the true reflections of the individual, these are the true reflections of the personality of the man. So mental symptoms, they have highest value while evaluating the symptoms. In that, we discussed already the symptoms related to will, then symptoms related to understanding, and finally symptoms related to memory we have to consider. These mental symptoms as well as physical general symptoms, they are helpful to individualize the patient. With the help of these symptoms, we can easily find out the personality of the patient, how the patient as a person. So these symptoms are very much important to individualize the patient as a person. After general symptoms, we have to consider the location, the symptom of location, which frequently furnish the characteristic symptom. Many times in location we get the peculiar symptoms, and they are noticed as to direction on which side the trouble start and in which direction the symptom move. Is it localized or it is move from one place to other place in any direction? So we discuss about the example of throat. If there is tonsillitis or throat pain, then patient while giving history, patient said that first there is pain on left side of the throat, then it goes from left to right, or it may be changing the sides continuously. There is fixed pain at one place. So how is the location? What is the location, exact location of the suffering? It is also very much important to find out the exact similimum. Then we discuss about the concomitant symptoms. The concomitant symptoms, they are very much useful symptoms, because these are not common symptoms, and these symptoms are symptoms which are helpful for individualization of the person. It is having the according to our master Dr. Hahnemann, he said these concomitant symptoms as a PQRS symptom, these symptoms are striking, single, rare, peculiar symptoms, and they helpful to individualize the patient as well as to find out the exact similima. And it is must necessarily follow that these concomitant symptoms have wide variety and are widely distributed throughout the organism. These symptoms rarely appear in connection with the leading disease and therefore are found rarely among the proteins. Those which belong to another sphere of disease than the principal element. Those which have more or less characteristic signs of the medicine, even though they have not before been noticed in the present relationship of diagnostic group. So these symptoms are very much important while making the totality, while evaluating the symptoms. Then after concomitant symptoms, the importance should be given to causative symptoms, the causative conditions, causative factors. In considering the value of symptoms, there are certain symptoms that are apparently caused by conditions and that almost precede the symptomatology and seem to give a basis for the patient's condition. So it is the important thing to find out the cause of the illness of the patient, because unless and until we cannot find out the cause, we cannot remove that cause. Till the removal of that cause, we cannot get the proper cure in the patient. So to find out the cause is the most important thing while taking the case. And they have given the examples of causative factors. The causative factors, it may be exposure to cold, exposure to wet, all those conditions of which people say that thus and so was the cause of their illness and the cause of their symptoms. So many times the patient was suffering from cough, cold, and while giving history, he gave the history that since he was exposed to cold, dry cold, wind, or since he was exposed to wet weather, his suffering or his complaints starts. So this is the cause of illness of the patient, or this is the cause what symptoms will appear. So these causative factors, they are very much important. They are also important to find out the similimum, as well as many times still we cannot remove the causative factors, we cannot get the exact cure. This embraces causes that are directly traceable to diet as well as climatic conditions. So we have to find out what may be the cause, because with the help of these causative factors, we can able to find out also the miasm behind the patient's suffering or the miasm of the patient. So causative factors are very much important. Then after causative factor, it comes susceptibility and idiosyncrasy. So susceptibility, what is susceptibility and idiosyncrasy? All of you know, you have covered these things in your philosophy in first, second year only. So susceptibility to disease condition and idiosyncrasies include in this category the symptoms that are produced by trade conditions come in this category, and the poisoning that may take place from too much drugging or from working in metals. So the susceptibility, to know the susceptibility and idiosyncrasy, it is also very much important thing. Symptoms produced from such conditions may be valuable in showing the pathological trend of the metal or gas or drug causing the condition, but they do not show the final differentiations, nor have they the same value that they do from the exhibition of the potencies. So to select the potency, to select how much frequently the medicine should be repeated, to know the patient by his susceptibility and idiosyncrasy, it is important. Sometimes these early symptoms will place the physician in the position of see clearly the basic miasmatic condition from which the patient is himself suffering. This should bear a large place in evaluation of symptoms. So these symptoms are very important symptoms. The symptoms which are related to the susceptibility and idiosyncrasy, these are important symptoms. Then modalities. The modalities are again important, as well as for differentiating from the group of similars, find out the exact similar from the group of similars, the modalities are very much helpful. In analyzing the case, very valuable symptoms are those pertaining to the aggravation and ameliorations. Because the aggravations and ameliorations are the natural modifiers of disease states and are the definite reaction of the man himself. So the aggravations and ameliorations, they have given the importance because these are the natural modifiers of the disease and have the definite reaction of the man himself. We must take into consideration that every symptom of note has these modifying conditions of aggravation and amelioration. So all the modifying factors, that means all the aggravations and ameliorations, we must take all these modalities into consideration while working on the case, because they are the natural modifiers of the disease state and give us the exact, the definite reaction of the man as well. So the modalities are very much important. Then there are different type of modalities. The modalities related to time, in the time, which time of the day, the time of the season, time of the moon, aggravation and amelioration from thermic conditions, from motion or rest of the part affected or of the condition as a whole, from lying down or sitting or standing, and the positions taken during each such conditions, waking or sleeping, and aggravation and amelioration from such positions and circumstances, the various positions in motion and aggravate and or ameliorate. The desire or aversion to eating and drinking, especially in feverish conditions, aggravations from certain foods and drinks. So the desire, aversion, as well as is there any aggravation from certain food, drink, these are all important things considered while giving importance to symptoms or while giving value to the symptoms when we are working on the case. These are all modifications that are of utmost importance in evaluating the symptoms. It is well to bear in mind the period of onset in periodic manifestations of symptoms, the increase, the acme, the decrease, and the end of disease manifestations in the evaluation of symptoms. For instance, conditions such as Sedron, Spigelia, Sanguinaria, Natrum Neur, these are very important. These remedies have a decided periodicity, and these are very important to consider also those symptoms that occur in the recession in the interval between the periods of aggravation. So all these modifications related to time, related to which we have seen in the previous slide, that modifications related to time, time of the day, time of season, time of moon, thermic conditions, then from moisturation of the part affected, conditions such as cold, lying down, sitting, standing, waking, sleeping, different positions in motion that aggravate or ameliorate, the desire or aversion to eating, drinking, especially in feverish condition, aggravations from certain food and drink, all these modifications, they are important, very much important in evaluating the symptoms of the case. Then contradictory symptoms. So the contradictory symptoms have an importance because they may rule out many of the remedies that otherwise might be considered in connection with an individual case. That is, symptoms that are decidedly opposed to the proving, like the thirstlessness of the fever of ignitia, or apis or pulsatilla, when fever is present and when other symptoms agree. So the contradictory symptoms means the symptoms which we cannot consider for that condition, and it is exactly unexpected symptom for that condition. For example, thirstlessness of fever. So usually during fever there is dehydration, so the thirst, normally naturally the thirst should increase during fever, but if there is thirstlessness during fever, then it is the contradictory symptom, and it is very important symptom because directly we find out the remedy with the help of these symptoms. For example, thirstlessness of fever of ignitia or apis or pulsatilla. Then contradictory symptoms may have a strong bearing in choosing the remedy from the standpoint of being themselves a symptom, just as a paucity of symptom may be a symptom in itself. as has been brought out in the provisions of the so-called two nothing remedies, which are often called for in profound state. So these symptoms, they have a strong bearing in choosing the remedy. They are very important to find out the similimum in short time with the help of these symptoms. For this reason, if you cannot find a remedy because of alternating or contradictory symptom, or for very lack of symptom, take these conditions as indications for symptoms of the very first try. So as these symptoms are contradictory symptoms, these symptoms are unexpected symptom for that disease condition. So while working on the case, when we get when we cannot able to find out the remedy and we get very few symptoms in the case, in that condition, these symptoms, with the help of these symptoms, we can able to find out the exact similimum. So these contradictory symptoms are very much helpful. Then lastly, the diagnostic symptoms. Diagnostic symptoms are nothing but the common symptoms of the that disease condition. So these are helpful to diagnose the disease condition. In considering the diagnostic symptoms in the selection of the remedy, it is only practical value. Its only practical value is in excluding those remedies from consideration which do not correspond to the genius of the disease, but act chiefly on other parts of the organism. So these symptoms when we select the remedy according to the disease diagnosis, then these diagnostic symptoms are useful and these are helpful, especially exclude the remedies which are not indicated for that disease condition. For example, anemia. In Kent repertory also we found the rubric anemia in generalities. So the anemia, it is a disease condition, it is a diagnostic rubric. Though Dr. Kent, he was critic of diagnostic rubric, then also he gave the or he mentioned the some diagnostic rubrics. We found some such rubrics in the in his repertory. Out of that, one is anemia, and this rubric, with the help of such rubrics, we can able to reach towards the indicated group of medicines. And the from the our huge materia medica, we get only the important medicines which are indicated for that disease condition, and exclude all other remedies from our huge or vast materia medica. So the diagnostic symptoms are useful to when we are finding out the remedies which are indicated for that disease condition, especially in advanced pathological condition, when we have to give temporary relief to the patient, we have to suppress the symptoms, we have to give temporary relief to the patient. At that time, we choose such diagnostic symptoms to find out the सिमिलिमम और मोस्ट इंडिकेटेड रेमेडीज. सो दिस वॉज द इवेल्युएशन ऑफ सिम्टम बाय रॉबर्ट्स. देन इवेल्युएशन ऑफ सिम्टम बाय डॉक्टर रिचर्ड ह्यूज. अकॉर्डिंग टू हिम सिमिलैरिटी बिटवीन डिसीज एंड ड्रग एक्शन शुड बी जेनेरिक स्पेसिफिक एंड इंडिविजुअल. What is generic similarity to make the case a simile of drug action? If the patient is ill, the remedy must be capable of producing illness in the healthy and more seriously ill he is. The more potent should be the poison which he is treating. For example, if the patient is febrile, his remedy must be pyrogenic. If inflammation, remedy should be irritant, and so on. In this way, we have to select the remedy according to its same nature. So there should be generic similarity. Then specific similarity means requisite of specific similarity should be drug should have same seat of action as the disease. Drug should have same kind of action, same originating cause of disease, character of pains and other sensation concomitant of the case. Then seat of action. The first requisite for the specific similarity is that the drug should have the same action as the disease. Identity of seat should be traced thoroughly and certainly. According to him, identity of seat is half the battle. Only half it is true, but to have conquered so far is fair promise of entire victory, and the promise is always fulfilled. Then same kind of action means pathological process shall be same, like fever, inflammation and ulceration. If the patient is having fever, then the medicine is also indicated for the condition of fever, inflammation and ulceration. Quality which such process receive from the diathesis or disease which they are outcome, which they are the outcome. So diathesis or the disease condition, it should be of same kind. Then intestinal ulceration occurred due to typhoid is different from ulceration as the ultimate issue of dysentery or as consequence of tuberculosis deposition in course of disease. So the quality which such process receive from the diathesis or disease, which are the outcome, which they are the outcome. Causative factors of disease. Another feature of specific similarity is that modification of disease, which its originating cause impress upon it, it differs according to as it is of physical and mental origin, and these classes have to be furtherly subdivided. Rheumatism arising from dry cold is different from damp cold. Neuralgia induced by injury to nerve is different from one brought on by malaria or gout. Then causal homeopathicity is of utmost value, and many a time leads as no other guide would to the specific remedy. Then the character of pain and other sensation. There is reason for why one should complain of burning pain, and another is of tearing, another is of gnawing pain. So the kind of sensation present characterize suffering, and on being found in pathogenicity, genesy establishes specific similarity of the drug which causes it. So the kind of sensation it gives the pathogenicity as well as it's helpful find out the specific similarity of the drug which causes it. Concomitant symptoms. It is coincidence of two or more marked symptoms in pathogenesis of drug and in the phenomena of disease. In this, you have to remember the Roberts method that we have to consider the or we have to work according to how he was given the hierarchy, how in which order he has given the importance or values to the symptom, and according to him, the individual similarity, that is individualization, is important in therapeutics. Typical disease affect each subject in his own way so that it presents a variety of species, and that which is distinctive in him must be taken into account. Patient's constitution and temperament, his mental emotional state, the condition of aggravation and amelioration, side of the body affected, the time, day or night at which the symptoms more pronounced must be taken into account in individual similarity. Then constitution. For example, bryonia to brunettes of bilious tendencies, arsenicum to worn and exhausted condition, nux vomica to vigorous person of dry habits and tense fiber, pulsatilla to lymphatic, dyspnea to nervous temperament in women and children. So in this way, the constitution is helpful to find out the temperament of the patient. Then the mental state. The mental and moral state of the patient is often a feature of his general temperament, but it may also supervene in the course of his existing malady. For example, emotional tension of aconite with fear of death, crossness of chamomilla, melancholia of aurum, and the entity of platina. So the mental symptoms which reflect how the person is. So these are very much important. Then the modalities. The condition of aggravation and amelioration have always played a large part in homeopathic therapeutics, and as there must be a cause for them, it would be wrong to ignore them. For example, the increase of the head pains of belladonna on lying down, of those of spigelia on stooping, the aggravations, lachesis after sleep, and the amelioration of nux vomica from the sleep. So these are the modalities which are also helpful to find out the exact